Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to the class Electric Machine 1, lecture number 4. Today we are going to study the armature reaction in DC generators. What is armature reaction? Armature reaction is the distortion and field weakening take place in both the motors and generators. It is the effect produced by the armature flux on the main flux. So here the current flowing in the armature coil also create a powerful magnetomotive force that distort and weaken the flux coming from the poles. This distortion and field weakening take place in both motors and generators. The effect produced by the armature MMF is called armature reaction. In the current flowing in an armature coil, it produces its own magnetic flux. This flux effect the main flux. So this is called the armature reaction. Suppose a figure in which we consider armature flux alone, meaning there is no flux generating from the magnetic field. So we consider for simplicity only the armature flux. If we consider the armature alone, it will produce a magnetic field as shown in figure below. This field acts at right angle to the field produced by the north and south poles. The intensity of the armature flux depends upon its MMF, which in turn depends upon the current carried by the armature. Thus, the armature flux is not constant but varies with load. Mean when current flow in armature, it produces a magnetic flux. This flux acts right angle to the flux produced by the north and south pole. And the intensity of the armature flux depends upon its MMF, and which in turn depend upon the current carried by the armature. Thus the armature flux is not constant, but it varies with the load, depends upon the load. So what is the effect or the problem due to armature reaction? Is shown in previous figure that the flux is in the neutral zone. And in neutral zone there it is no longer zero. There is a flux in the neutral zone also, which we studied in our previous class, that there is no flux and we put our carbon bridges here. So in the figure it is shown that there is an armature flux in the neutral zone as well. As a result, the voltage will be induced in the coil that are short-circuited by the brushes. As a result, severe sparking may occur. The intensity of the sparking will depend upon the armature flux and hence upon the load current delivered by the generator. This is the one issue generated from armature reaction. The second problem created by the armature MMF is that it distorts the flux produced by the poles, meaning the main flux. In fact, the combination of the armature MMF and field MMF produce a resultant magnetic field. Due to the attraction of the main flux and the armature flux, they produce a resultant magnetic field. The neutral zone have shifted in the direction of rotation of the armature. This occurs in all DC generators. The third one is the total flux produced by the north and south pole is less than it was when the generator was running at no load. This caused a corresponding reduction in induced voltage. Because of the attraction of the armature flux or weakened the main flux. So in this way, the induced voltage become reduced compared to no load. So for large machine, the decrease in the flux may be as much as 10%. Now shift brushes to improve commutation. We shift the brushes in order to improve commutation due to the shift in the neutral zone when the generator is under load. Due to armature reaction, we could move the brushes to reduce the sparking. For a generator, the brushes are shifted to the new neutral zone by moving them in the direction of rotation. For motor, the brushes are shifted against the direction of rotation in order to improve commutation due to the armature reaction. This problem is generated. So for this purpose, we need a new neutral zone by moving them in the direction of rotation in generators and against the direction of rotation in motors. It is a theoretical concept. Practical, we make other arrangements that we will study in the coming classes. Shift brushes to improve commutation. As soon as the brushes are moved, commutation improves. Mean there is less sparking. However, if the load fluctuates, the armature MMF rise and fall, and so the neutral zone shift back and forth between the no load and full load position. We would therefore have to move the brushes back and forth to obtain sparkless commutation. Once the commutation improves, mean there will be less sparking. However, if the load fluctuates, the armature flux rise and fall, and so the neutral zone we need to shift back and forth between no load and full load position. We would therefore have to move the brushes back and forth to obtain sparkless commutation. Now there are few types of generators, in which two of them are the most passive one. One is separately excited generators and the other is not separately excited, mean it will not require any source, DC source. So first we will study separately excited generator. Instead of using permanent to create the magnetic field, we can use a pair of electromagnetic coil field poles. When the DC field current in such a generator is supplied by an independent source such as storage, battery or another generator called an exciter, the generator is said to be a separately excited generator. One, we use electromagnetic or field poles made up of winding, and we supply it through excitation in it. Here we generate magnetic field. So this source of excitation, the outer source, some battery, some generator, is called exciter, and in this way we call the generator separately excited generator. As shown in the figure, it has a DC supply to the feed winding, and in this way current is produced, and which in turn produce a flux. They interact or cut the armature conductor, and here EMF induced and current flow, and we connect the load. This is the armature, the load, this is the field winding, and this is the external DC supply. So this is called a separately excited generator. Thus the DC source connected to the terminal AB causing excitation current IX or IF to flow. If the armature is driven by a motor or diesel engine, voltage E naught appear between bushes terminals X and Y as we studied in the basic generator type. Now another one is a shunt generator. This is the diagram of a shunt generator. Shunt parallel. Field winding is parallel with the armature winding. So a shunt excited generator is a machine whose shunt field winding is connected in parallel with the armature winding so that the generator can be self-excited. The principal advantage of this connection is that it eliminates the need for an external source of excitation. In a previous case, we need a separately source of excitation. Here, we don't need that. How is self-excitation achieved? When a shunt generator is started, small voltage is induced in the armature due to the remnant flux in the poles. There is always some flux in the pole, which we called residual flux. This voltage produces a small excitation current IX in the shunt field. The resulting small MMF act in the same direction as the residual flux or remnant flux, causing the flux per pole to increase. The increased flux increase E naught, which increase IX or I. In this way flux increase, which increase E naught even more, and so on. The progressive buildup continue until E naught reach a maximum value determined by the field resistance and the degree of saturation. Initially there is a small flux that produce that cut the armature, and in this way the flux is built up and a voltage is induced, and it's continuously increasing until it reaches to its maximum value. And in this way we achieve self-excitation. Shunt generator under load. The terminal voltage of a self-excited shunt generator fall off more sharply with increasing load than that of separately excited generator. The reason is that the field current in a separately excited machine remain constant, whereas in a self-excited generator the excitation current fall as the terminal voltage drop. For a self-excited generator, a drop in the voltage from no load to full load is about 15% of the full load voltage, where for a separately excited generator it is usually less than 10%. The voltage regulation is said to be 15 and 10% respectively. In shunt generator, the voltage drop sharply as compared to the separately excited generator. The reason is that the field current in a separately excited machine remain constant, whereas in self-excited generator the excitation current fall as the terminal voltage drop. So there is a difference of voltage regulation between the two, the one less than 10% and the other is almost 15%. Another one is a compound generator. Compound generator is a type of generator in which we have both series field and shunt field. One in series with the armature and the other is parallel with the armature. So the compound generator was developed to prevent the terminal voltage of the DC generator from decreasing with increasing load, as we studied in the last case. Thus, although we can usually tolerate a reasonable drop in terminal voltage as the load increases, this has a serious effect on lighting circuits. A compound generator is similar to a shunt generator, except that it has an additional field coil connected in series with the armature. These series field coils are composed of few turns of heavy wire big enough to carry the armature current. The total resistance of the series coil is therefore small. The magnetic flux produced by the series winding assists the flux produced by the shunt field winding. The generator is said to be cumulative compound wound generator, and when the series field flux opposes the shunt field flux, then the generator is said to be a differentially compound generator. These are the two types of compound generator, in which when series field assists the flux produced by the shunt field, we call it cumulative compound, and when it opposes the field flux in parallel, generator is called differentially compound generator. This is the compound generator diagram. Now, construction of a direct current generator or DC generator. Up till now we described the basic feature and properties of DC generator. We now look at the mechanical construction of this machine, in which we have to study the armature, the commutator, the windings and the brushes. So first of all, we are going to study the field winding. The field produced by the magnetic flux in the machine, it is basically a stationary electromagnetic composed of a set of silent poles bolted to the inside of a circular frame. Field coil mounted on the poles carry the DC excited current. The frame is usually made up of solid cast steel, whereas the pole pieces are composed of iron lamination. In some generators, the flux is created by the permanent magnet. So the field produces magnetic flux, meaning the field winding produces flux, which we call the field flux or the main flux in the machine. It is basically stationary, meaning they are not moving. And there are two types, silent and non-silent poles generators. So field coils mounted on the poles shoes and carry the DC exciting current, which we provide through the excitation. In our discussion so far, we have considered only two pole generator. However, in practice, a DC generator or motor may have 2, 4, 6 or as many as 24 poles. The number of poles depend upon the physical size of the machine. The bigger it is, the more pole it will have. This is the diagram, the field poles, north, south. This is the field pole. The field coils of a multi-pole machine are connected together so that adjacent poles have opposite magnetic polarities, meaning north and south. Shunt field coils are composed of several hundred turns of wire carrying a relatively small current. The coil are insulated from the pole piece to prevent short circuiting. So this is about the field winding. In the coming lecture, we will study the other parts of the generator. Inshallah.